All right, Harvest North Shore, what's up? Man, you guys sound so good this morning. I love your enthusiasm. I was here on the front row hearing you all singing back to the worship team. That was amazing to hear. I love this campus. I was here for the first time. It will be a year ago. Next week will be a year that I was here for my first time. And we were here with the goal of witnessing to the community, the surrounding communities of this church. And it was an idea for one of our young adults. And so we met up here. We grabbed a bunch of chairs and put them in a circle. We had a time of worship. A few of your elders were here. But last year, if you remember, Halloween fell on a Saturday. And so we wanted to go out into the community on that Saturday morning and pass out candy with the hopes of bringing people Jesus to their front doorstep. And we are in the series called We Are Witnesses. And I don't think it's any coincidence that I'm here almost a year ago from next week talking about witnessing. And a witness is someone that has seen something and goes and tells what they've seen. I hope that you guys are really enjoying the series that we're coming in, that we're in the book of Acts, also known as the Acts of the Apostles. I refer to it as the Acts of the Holy Spirit. And it's like the Gospels, the four Gospels, was the training ground for the disciples. And here we are in Acts, like, okay, now let's go. Now it's time to go into action. And sometimes, I'm sure, I don't know, sometimes I'm watching the news and I see some of the things that are going on. And I've even heard people say this, that when they're watching the news, they say, the church should do something about that. Have you ever been there where you're like, man, the church needs to do something about that? And some of those things might be true and accurate. I believe that if every person was a believer, I don't think that we'd be having the problems that we're having today. I believe that sometimes the church does need to do more, but I think part of the problem is that the church doesn't know what they should be doing. And when I say the church, I'm talking about the people of God. And if COVID has shown us anything, it's that church is not about a building, it's about the people. Every person should be leading the way as an example that Jesus Christ has left for us. And so over the last 2 weeks, we learned what makes a healthy church. And I'm not going to ask anyone to stand up and recite the list because I'm sure you guys know what's on that list. But when you get to the bottom of the list, it says, reach the lost. And as we turn into chapter 3 today, we transition into this phase from the call to go to actually going. And so you see this picture of two followers of Christ. That's Peter and John, who are just living another day in the life of a follower of Christ. So, in the words of the great Jeff Bucknum, you're going to need a Bible today, all right? Or you're going to need your Acts notebook. And why don't you meet me at Acts chapter 3, verses 1 through 10, and let's just read it. It says, now Peter and John were going up to the temple at the hour of prayer. The ninth hour, and a man lame from birth was being carried, whom they laid daily at the gate of the temple that is called the Beautiful Gate, to ask for alms of those entering the temple. Seeing Peter and John about to go into the temple, he asked to receive alms. And Peter directed his gaze on him, as did John, and said, look at us. And he fixed his attention on them, expecting to receive something from them. But Peter said, I have no silver or gold, but what I do have, I give to you in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Rise up and walk. And he took him by his right hand and raised him up. And immediately his feet and ankles were made strong. And leaping up, he stood and began to walk. And he entered the temple with them, walking and leaping and praising God. And all of the people saw him walking and praising God and recognized him as the man who sat at the beautiful gate of the temple asking for alms. And they were filled with wonder and amazement at what had happened to him. Let's pray. Lord, we just thank you for this opportunity to come together and worship you in spirit and in truth. And so, God, as we open your word together and hear what you have for us this morning, will you just allow this to penetrate our hearts? Will you use your word to change us? We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. We know that in Acts chapter 1 and 8, Jesus tells the disciples that you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Judea and Jerusalem, Judea and Samaria, and to the end of the earth, or to the end of the world, in the ESV translation. And here we are at the temple in Jerusalem, the first stop. In verse 1, you see it says, now Peter and John were going to the temple at the hour of prayer, the ninth hour. Which brings us to our first point, if you're taking notes this morning. Witnesses go to lost people. Witnesses go to lost people. And what we see here is John and Peter going to the temple at the 3 o'clock hour. We don't see anywhere in the Bible that can explain why they went at this particular time other than the Holy Spirit leading them there. The temple was filled with people who were praying, and most or all of them did not believe that Jesus Christ was the Messiah foretold in the Old Testament. So this couldn't be a better audience, right, for a miracle to occur. This miracle has theological implications as well, because in Isaiah chapter 35, verses 5 and 6, it says this, that the eyes of the blind shall be opened, and the ears of the deaf unstopped, and then the lame man will leap like a deer. So Isaiah is prophesying what is actually happening here in Acts. Notice he said the lame man. He didn't say lame men. He's specifically talking about this man in the temple on this day. So you have an audience of many of whom are scholars and study the Old Testament, right? So they've read the book of Isaiah, and they're going to be witnessing this miracle come to pass, foretold in the Old Testament. Verse 2, and a man lame from birth was being carried, whom they laid daily at the gate of the temple that is called the Beautiful Gate, to ask for alms of those entering the temple. So what do we know about this man? We know that he has been lame from birth. Many biblical scholars say that this man was about 40 years old. So this man had been lame for 40 years, which means he's never walked, never considered walking, never thought he would walk. He probably expected that his life was going to be going to the temple every day to ask for money. It's not really a positive outlook on life, right? This man's situation was pretty hopeless, so he probably just accepted that this is just how it's going to be. You ever run into someone who has been just defeated and is hopeless and nothing never seems to go their way ever? Who's accepted their current condition, and because of it, they've remained crippled in their circumstances. Not able or willing to move forward to doing anything productive or anything different from their current situation. We've seen this now even during the pandemic. Pastor Jeff kind of alluded to that last week, so I won't get back into that. I don't want to get any emails this week. But sometimes Christians too can become crippled by their circumstances and their situations. So you and I have been this man. This man has never walked. So in order for that to happen, he would need a miracle. His legs and his ankles just don't work, and it's been like this for 40 years. He had to be carried to the temple every day, so he was a burden to his friends and his family. But he was sitting in an opportune spot. All right, his legs didn't work, but his mind seemed to be working pretty well because he was at the beautiful gate. And if you know anything about the Jewish religion, number one, well, they have three major principles. And number one is to understand the Torah, which is the first five books of the Old Testament. And number two is to worship and pray. And number three is to give charity to those who are suffering and disabled. One of the amazing attributes of God is that he is always focused on the people who are not focused on, and he cares about the people that no one else cares about. He loves the unlovable, and he reaches out to those who no one else is reaching out to. That's just who he is. And so God challenged the Jewish people to do the same thing. So on the way to the temple, they would have money available to minister to the poor, to the widows, and to the disabled. And this was a part of their religious nature to give to people. And so this lame man knew this. So he was strategically placed at the beautiful gate. All right. So at the temple, there's 10 gates. 9 of them are covered with silver and gold. But the amazing thing is that wasn't the beautiful gate. The beautiful gate was completely covered with this Corinthian bronze, which is this highly valuable metal alloy that is no longer in existence. So this man was placed here every day, probably because all of the rich people went through that gate. But the amazing thing here that I want you to focus on is that he was not allowed to go in. Disabled, crippled, they were not allowed to go into the temple. So many of these people walked past him every day, dropping money in the cup just to check a box. Verse 3, seeing Peter and John about to go into the temple, he asked to receive alms. And verse 4 says, Peter directed his gaze on him, as did John, and said, look at us. And when I read this, I immediately thought, wake up. Let me get your attention here. Lift up your head. Look to the hills which cometh your help. Your help comes from the Lord. Awaken, ye sleeper. Verse 5 says, and he fixed his attention on them, expecting to receive something from them. I believe that this man was like, wow. After all of this time, someone has finally spoken to me. I really sense that this guy's posture was like this. As he's hearing people walk past, he's hearing people have conversations as he's walking past, as they drop their token in his cup. This lame man asked for what he wanted, but he was about to receive what he needed. Verse 6. Peter said, I have no silver or gold, but what I do have, I give to you in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Rise up and walk. What an amazing statement, right? Our second point here is witnesses give what they have. Witnesses give what they have. Notice Peter said, I don't have any money. And we know this because in Acts chapter 2, verse 45, it says that they sold everything to follow Jesus. So Peter's like, I don't have what you think I have, but I'm about to give you what you need. Many of us have had personal situations in our life, right? Maybe it's a friend or a coworker or a relative that is going through something and we just didn't have any answers for them. Sometimes you hear stories and you are just at a loss for words. And it's like, I don't have the answer, but I know who does. Peter said, I'm going to give you what I have. I don't have any money. In fact, money is not going to make you whole, all right? What you're asking for will have you right back here tomorrow asking for the same thing again. I can't fix your sickness. I can't provide all of your financial needs. But what I do have, I give it to you, and it is an answer to all of your problems. Money is a temporary fix, but Jesus is a permanent one. He said, in Jesus' name, rise up and walk. And when Peter calls on Jesus' name, he's calling on the authority given to him as an apostle of God. Peter was just the agent, not the source of the power. And although through Peter, Jesus continued his healing ministry, representing his divine authority and continuing the power to grant blessings and effect miracles and salvation. The name in question is not Jesus, but the name that belongs to Jesus by the virtue of his resurrection and glorification. As referenced in Acts chapter 2, verse 36, which says that he is Lord and Christ. It's not this magical use of the name Jesus that heals this man. It is the authority of Jesus. The healing didn't come from the proximity of religious practice. The healing came from the power of Jesus. Verse 9. And he, Peter, took him by the right hand and raised him up. And immediately his feet and ankles were made strong. Verse 8. And leaping up, he stood and began to walk and entered the temple with them walking and leaping and praising God. At this moment, he was complete. He was made whole. The book of Isaiah has come to life right here. This lame man, after 40 years, is leaping like a deer. He didn't have to undergo physical therapy, okay? He didn't have to take any medicine. He was healed instantly, and now his life is changed forever. Life's changed. That's what Jesus does. And his healing was instantaneous. And that indeed was a miracle. This situation begs the question of, do miracles like this still exist today? Well, first I want to say anything is possible through prayer if it's God's will. You see, miracles in Scripture like this and what we see in Acts are acts of God that proclaim his sovereign power over creation, as well as his commitment to the good of his people. Miracles are often significant because they serve as a larger purpose in God's perspective, redemptive plan, like what we see here, testifying to the authority of God's messengers who bring his revelation to humanity. This is one of the primary functions of miracles in the Scriptures. When miracles occur, they give evidence that God is truly at work and so serve to advance the gospel. Miracles authenticate God's message to his messengers. And what we know from what the Bible tells us is that God only gave this authority to the 12 apostles. Verse 9, and all of the people saw him walking and praising God. Verse 10, and recognizing him as the one who sat at the beautiful gate of the temple asking for alms. And they were filled with wonder and amazement at what had happened to him. Our last point is witnesses glorify God always. We are all this man, right? We've been there. We are witnesses of what God has done in our lives. So we should be glorifying God always in all of our actions. Whenever we see people, we don't walk past them. Whenever we hear about situations that we don't have the answers to, we point people to the person who has all the answers. But the question I had when I read through this was the man saved? Because it really doesn't talk about it here. It doesn't say yes, and then the man was saved. But I believe that by the fact that this man ran into the temple, it is evidence that he was saved, because now he has access. Before, he was not allowed in the temple, but now he's healed and he can go in. When God does something amazing in someone's life, he will usually use it for a greater purpose. When something like this happens, it's amazing to see all of the lives that are impacted by it. The Holy Spirit worked in this lame man's life and then worked through the man so that the truth might be proclaimed to a large crowd of people and to the Jewish leaders. His transformation ultimately led to the salvation of many people in the temple. All of this took place because God acted in the life of a simple beggar who responded with a public praise after an intentional act by two followers of Jesus Christ. This was a chain reaction that started with an intentional act. The question is, as a church, are we being intentional about going after lost people? You know, when I first came here, one of the first things that I did ministry-wise was kind of started this evangelism thing, and we called it witness nights, and we would witness at Whitfield Mall in the wintertime, and then periodically on the streets in Arlington Heights, and you know, people would hear about it, and they would say, "Wow, Ramirez, you really have a heart for evangelism," and actually, I don't, because I really don't like doing it, but I do it out of obedience. I do it because someone did it for me. Many of you might have heard my testimony, the God at Work story, and within that story was an encounter that I had with a Chicago police officer, and I was caught red-handed. So this guy had every right to take me to jail. He had the evidence right there. And statistics would have told you that I did go to jail that day because I was an African-American man on the south side of Chicago. I got pulled over by a Caucasian cop. And automatically, you're just like, I'm going to jail today. But instead, he chose to minister to me. And that had an impact on my walk. You see, I grew up in church, but I went away from the Lord to try to find my own way and got lost in the process. And God used the Chicago police officer to put me back on track. It was through this intentional action by the Chicago police officer that not only impacted my life, but it impacted so many other lives. And that's amazing. It is a perfect picture of one plants a seed, another person waters, but ultimately it's God who gives the increase. And we see that here with this situation as well. Because of this intentional action by John and Peter, the gospel went out everywhere. Jewish people who did not believe that Jesus Christ was the Messiah believed that he was the Messiah. And I believe that they went on and told more people, and so on and so forth. And just like the Chicago police officer, he witnessed to me, and now I preach to hundreds of people and probably thousands by now. And maybe someone's life has been impacted. You never know what God wants to do through you. But it starts with an intentional action by you, the church. This lame man was not allowed into the temple. You know, some of the times God's best work happens outside of the church. I was redirected on the south side, on the side of the road. This man was saved and healed outside of the temple. Let's not be like the religious people checking the box, going into church, but not being the church. Walking past him every day, these people, just like, here you go. I checked that box today. Let that not be us. I want to encourage you, as we go out this week, to watch for opportunities. All right? There's people who are hurting in this world. Let's not be the believer or the church that's on the couch saying, man, the church should do something about that. Well, you are the church. So the responsibility is ours. We can also look for the needs of others. We can serve in the authority of Jesus Christ. We have been miraculously healed through the power of the Holy Spirit. So now we get to go and heal someone else. Are we praising the Lord like this man and sharing what God has done for us? You know, witnessing isn't always like on the corner with a microphone, all right? It is actually living out a Christian life in front of others. And when God gives you the opportunity, you share. One of the things that me and my wife chose to do for our neighborhood was just that. We used to live in a very closely knit neighborhood. We were like a family, but many of our neighbors didn't know the Lord. So we just decided to live it out in front of them. We said that we would not hit them over the head with a Bible. We would live it out and then just trust the Lord that we'd have an opportunity to share someday. And so it seemed that whenever there was a problem in the neighborhood with teenagers, they would come to us, and we didn't have teenagers. And we're like, yes, we gotcha. God just wants a willing heart. God knows your heart. Sometimes it's just an intentional prayer, like, Lord, I want to witness for you. I want to do this. I don't know how to do it. Lord, show me. Give me an opportunity. Show me the people that you're bringing to me. And then, Lord, give me the right words to say at that time that will provoke change in someone's life. And it doesn't always happen that moment. You know, some of my best times witnessing are usually when it starts like, no, get away from me, you Jesus freak. Because I know that God, if I just persevere, I know the Lord is going to show up in an amazing way. And he always does. Man, one of the highlights for me at Harvest since I've been here, I've been on staff for 3.5 years now, is what the Lord is doing in our Hope Centers. And I look forward to doing that every week. My daughter is addicted to serving there, which is amazing. Witness these people coming to our church, hopeless, thinking that they're coming there for food, but leave with hope. That's just what happened with this man. He was coming there looking for money, but left with hope. It's amazing to see the people come into our doors each week. And the way that we witness to them is love, kindness, using that fifth pillar of unconditional love. There's this lady who came up to me one weekend, and she grew up in the Catholic Church. And she was just so excited to share with me Pastor, did you know that Jesus had a brother? And I'm like, yeah, technically, yes. He had a half-brother, and his name was James. Would you like to read the book of James? And she said, yeah, but I don't have a Bible. I'm like, well, we can fix that for you. So I went and grabbed the Bible for her, and she took it, and she was amazed that someone gave her a Bible. We have a waiting room at the Hope Center. So she went back into the waiting room, and she's showing everyone her Bible. And she's like, look, look at my Bible. Praising the Lord. Leaping like a deer. And each week, she's like, yeah, I read through the book of James. It's just so amazing. Isn't it amazing to see the enthusiasm in someone over something that we sometimes take for granted? But it's contagious. Now other people are like, so now we just put the Bibles out on the table, and we started with 10, and there were two left last week. Last week, I think we served 98 families. But people are coming into our church. They're learning about the Lord. They're getting hope. They're being healed. They're sharing with others. There was someone who was baptized 3 weeks ago when we did the spontaneous baptism, who came to our church through the Hope Center. I know of about 5 people that came to our church through the Hope Center that are in small group right now. There's a man who came to the Hope Center about a year ago, joined a small group, joined our church, and is now on staff as a maintenance person at our Rolling Meadows campus. Lives are being changed. I would encourage you to just come and see what God is doing on Saturday mornings at the Hope Center between the hours of 10 and 12. You could just come and serve, and you shop with the people, you get to know them, and you get to know their story, and ultimately the goal is to share Jesus with them in a loving, not forceful way. This is the day in the life of the followers of Christ in this story here. And you're going to see this reoccurring theme throughout the book of Acts. We're in that action phase, guys. Anybody excited about that? Yes, come on, let's go. On Thursday night, I preached to our young adults a theme of let's go. And it was based on Peter walking on water. And we have these wristbands that we gave to our young adults. And it says, boldest risk takers. We should be willing and ready to take a risk for Jesus Christ. What do we have to lose? Okay. What do we have to lose, guys? The best risk you could ever take. The return on investment is amazing. You can't go wrong. So, guys, let's walk away today with these 3 things in mind. We go, we give what we have, and we glorify the Lord. But as we do that, Jesus will do the rest. Right? Yeah. Because Jesus can. He can do it. Amen.